This is Brett from Blue Stolly, and welcome to this commentary thing that you're listening to. This track, the beginning, the first half of this song was written for the trailer for X-Men Days of Future Past. They needed a track to serve as the intro for this big epic movie, so the first minute of this song is what I wrote for the film and what appears in the trailer, one of the trailers. When the decision was made to include it as part of the album as a whole, I wrote the big techie war drum section. The pulses during the back end are a mix of synths layered with a chopped up distorted cello. Since this track is already part of a trailer, I wanted it to introduce the album like a big cinematic landscape opening up in front of you. This song existed in an early demo form that just had the thrash intro and the payoff as you hear it, as well as the drop into the halftime mid-tempo groove with a drum loop, pretty much marking for myself, cool stuff goes here for me to work out later. Around the same time that I was figuring out how the full song would be fleshed out, Emma Anzai from the band Sick Puppies and I crossed paths, and she said that if I ever needed extra bass on a track, that she would be down to provide it. Emma is absolutely one of the best bassists in rock and roll, as well as a killer vocalist, so it was amazing to be able to give her space to go absolutely nuts on this track and get some backing vocals as well. In a track like this, where I have a ton of complex stuff going on, and all stacked on top of each other, I sometimes edit and time correct certain aspects of the live elements to give the organics a bit of an electronic precision. The crazy thing is, Emma's performance was so insanely perfect that when I zoomed in to the sample level to chop stuff up and edit, it was impressive as all hell how close to the grid within mere cycles she was. So even during the tedious parts of production, it was an honor to see a master at their craft just kicking ass. This song really feels like planting the flag in the ground of what Blue Stolly on this album is all about. Hell, it's multi-genre all within one track. You have thrash guitar riffs with drum and bass breakbeats, walls of electronics, glitch hop and funk, and a chorus that's just straight up pop. A common theme running through this album is a complete disregard for current trends or whatever tastemakers are jerking themselves off over for the next 5 minutes before moving on. I pretty much threw my hands up and just said, screw it, I'm just gonna do what I want. Armageddon is a perfect example of that approach. With the exception of the modular acid lines that show up in the second verse and the bridge, all the synths in this track are early 90s rave samples. The hoovers, the stabs, the effects, the dance vocals, all from old school sample CDs. I wanted to pay tribute to that feeling of walking home with weird rave compilation discs and hearing The Prodigy for the first time and watching low-budget straight-to-video sci-fi and horror. On that tip, this is also a bit of an homage to one of my favorite movies of all time. Yes, Richard Stanley's phenomenal post-apocalyptic cyberpunk radness from 1990, Hardware. The feel of this song is meant to feel like the color palette and atmosphere of that film, and I freaked out when I found that in one of those old sample discs, I had one of the very same synth samples that the film's composer used. And speaking of inspiration, that composer, Simon Boswell, also did the score to the movie Hackers, which I also love dearly. Oh, I mentioned modular synths earlier. The second verse and the big massive breakbeat bridge of this song have these awesome acid techno lines. Those were made with Clayton of Celldweller in the spaceship of his studio with the modular gear that lines the walls. We just experimented with running random sequences through different modules and recorded about 30 minutes of audio that I sifted through and chopped out the parts that I wanted to use. So this track has the old school sampling vibe throughout. Oh, something else fun is that in this song, in the hook with the whole Armageddon come and get it bit, sure, you hear me yelling, and that's pretty clear, but there are also some gang shout-out vocals comprised of the Surly Dude Mass Choir, a mysterious and shadowy cabal rumored to be a well-known active radio rock band, slumming it on one of my tracks for kicks. This song is really what laid the groundwork for how the rest of this album would be approached. Originally, this album was going to be super raw, dirty, and have a somewhat lo-fi vibe. This track went through a few different versions, and nothing really felt quite right enough to call it finished. While driving around aimlessly and listening to music, the lightning rod of an idea smacked me in the face, and I wanted to try an experiment of mixing elements of pop production alongside big chainsaw guitar riffs. Using this song as a canvas, I did my favorite thing, which is smashing disparate genres together, just to make something exciting for me. This is also where I made the call that I was going to pull way back on the screaming from the previous vocal album. It just wasn't interesting to me anymore, and I was more excited by the idea of making the guitars bigger, louder, and meaner, while simultaneously making the vocals more melodic and catchy. There are guitars all over the place, including a wildly flailing guitar solo, because this was coming off the heels of my album Anti-Sleep Volume 3, which was way more in the direction of synths and sound design over guitars. There were a few people who apparently didn't understand that Bluestolly has always been a multi-genre project for as long as it has existed, and they voiced some concern that I had abandoned guitars completely instead of just doing multiple genres as I have for years. So, as this was going to be the first thing that people heard from the new album, I wanted to dispel all of that right out of the gate. Pretty much, here's all the guitars you assumed I forgot about. You may now choke on them. The vocal melody for the verse of this song goes all the way back to when I was 17. Not gonna tell you how long that is. It's just been, you know, banging away in the back of my brain until finally being put to use. You can always tell when I have a musical idea that won't leave my head, because you can hear it when I run. It's like putting a rock in an empty coffee can and shaking it around. And yes, I just compared my own brain to an empty coffee can. I know full well what that implies. Anyway, there was a demo of this song that was written during the time of the debut self-titled Bluestolly album, but it didn't really make the cut because that sound was kind of already represented elsewhere on that album. And I'm glad I waited until now to actually make it, because this version feels like everything I wanted it to be back then but couldn't pinpoint. I fully wanted the vibe of this song to feel like you're wandering alone through the event horizon. All the glitchy sound design in this track is directly tied to my love of sci-fi horror and music that is based on being more like a sound collage. And continuing with the theme of screw the genres and the trends, I'm just gonna do what I want. Ready, Aim, Fire is just full-on dirty breakbeats, chopped-up vinyl samples, overdriven bass guitar, and treating my own guitar takes as samples. A lot of the elements that are in here are from the demo of that song. There was an auto-wah on the guitar, and I was stemming out different takes to do the main riff, but in the end, the very first two things that I played were what wound up sounding the coolest. Sometimes that's how it works. I love the hell out of approaching something that will have a bit of a rock vibe with purely electronic and hip-hop sampling techniques. This is another track that is a bit of a love letter to influential music for me. I remember hearing bands that broke off from the basic tried-and-true rock and roll setup and incorporated sampling, and that stuff blew my mind. Using drum loops alongside or instead of a drummer, treating their guitars like sampled elements or turntablist DJs incorporating guitar riffs and samples of rock bands alongside hip-hop, hearing things like that just clicked with me and was exactly what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. So the vibe of this song is like an homage to the stuff I'd hear in my head when imagining action movie scenes or scribbling out my own comics. I used to draw a ton before music took over for me. Most all of the synths in this track are chopped up, manipulated old school samples, mostly of the vinyl variety. The only thing born from current synthesis is that arpeggiated top line. For just a red-hot minute, I considered releasing this track as a single on its own, kind of like what I did with Never Dance Again, instead of including this as part of the album, because it's just so different in tone. That short-lived hesitation was kicked in the face as I once more decided, screw it, it's my album, and I can do whatever I want. You never really know what the reaction is going to be to a song, and I was fully anticipating people telling me that they thought the lyrics were cheesy, or any number of things. What sparked the reason for this song existing was wanting to make something for both kids and families in the hospital dealing with heavy diagnosis or growing up in abuse or having to be like placed in foster care. Oftentimes when you're in a situation like that, or really anything that seems like it's completely insurmountable and hopeless, a song with complex and abstract lyrical concepts isn't exactly what you need. Sometimes it's the simple guilty pleasure track with a straightforward approach that turns out to be the lifeline. This is probably the most musically straightforward song on the album, just a big-ass rock and roll riff, drum loops, and vocal melodies. Some songs have layers upon layers of hidden atmospheres and effects, so I wanted to balance that with a song that, well, I guess also it still has a lot of that. But this is a bit more of a direct shot. This is what I worked on alongside Down in Flames, and aimed to make this a much more guitar-oriented album. It's another instance where I just love the juxtaposition of big guitars with very melodic vocals. And if you want a band full of screaming, then I'll tell you what, Blue Staly is not for you. You'll have to settle for the million other bands that do that. Jesus. Most of the time, when people ask me what a song is about, I tell them that the important thing is their own interpretation. But since there's a way that this particular track could be misconstrued if not paid attention to, this will be one of those rare occasions where I do tell you what this song is about. This track came about when I saw Rolling Stone put that stupid Boston Bomber kid on the cover of their rag like he was some kind of rock star, instead of a worthless cowardly trash who just murdered a bunch of people and doesn't deserve to have his name in print. That seems to be the normal pattern when tragedy strikes. Instead of keeping it localized and doing everything they can to discourage copycats, major media outlets fawn over every aspect of these turds' lives for ratings and clicks on their dumb websites, pretty much encouraging the next one and the one after that, just like they're recycling pop stars. So the lyrics of this track are written from the perspective of that ratings-hungry beast, like their sleazy producer types, leading a talentless hopeful back to the casting couch with promises of stardom. Like, we'll put your name in lights, kid, but first you gotta do this one thing for me. They aren't concerned with actually stopping any of this or advancing a discussion on possible solutions. It's just indulgent rubbernecking. And that's also why the chorus of the song is so upbeat and sing-songy. The real insidiousness of that agenda is that it's hidden beneath the veneer of informative thoughtfulness. This track is another one where a lot of the elements from the original demo stayed through the final track. Most of the guitars are from the quick takes that I threw down so I wouldn't forget the idea. Same goes for a lot of the drum and bass breaks. In the bridge, where it drops into halftime with the big guitar chugs just before the thrash metal lines come in, there's some cool modular synth craziness that, again, was made in a session with Clayton where we just randomized sequences and flipped parameters around various modular hardware while recording the whole lot out, giving me about 20 minutes of strange synth sequences to dig through and chop up. The funny thing is that it's such a small element of an even smaller part of the song, but it has all this fun nonsense behind it. In the chorus are some chopped up, repitched samples that also kick the track off, and it's because glitchy French house stuff is some of my favorite, and I like mixing that influence in. For the lyrics and vocals, this was one of the few times that I got the chorus melody and lyrics right at the outset of the demo process. Usually, I write all the music first and then set about trying to figure out vocals and lyrics for it. So having this chorus hook from the beginning was a great way to steer the rest of the song. When the possibility arose that Mark Solomon would be available to do the vocals on this song, I wrote the verse and vocal melody lyrics specifically for his delivery. They wouldn't be the same if I sang them. It needs his human pitbull-esque forcefulness. I was a big fan of Mark's from his appearances on Argyle Park and the multitude of bands that he's either fronted or guested with. One of the things that shaped my musical attitude growing up was seeing his band Stavesaker perform, and midway through their set, after a song had finished, some frustrated guy in the crowd yelled out, "Play a fast song!" Of course, that's not the style that they chose to play. So Mark leans in real close, looks this dude dead in the eye, and very authoritatively says, "Start your own band." Then they launch into their next song, and that was freaking badass. The lyrical inspiration for this track stems from my absolute seething hatred of ladder climbers who are especially rampant in this industry. I've had my fill. And now we come to the title track. I wanted this one to be the most atmospheric on the album. There are hidden layers, effects, and cinematic bits throughout. Actually, that's something that's been done on every song on this record. Stacks of things that will hopefully result in you hearing something new, or just hearing something different depending on the environment that you're listening in. One of my favorite experiences is listening to a song that I've loved for years and picking up on an element that I never noticed before. So I hope that this entire album provides you with the same reward of having new elements present themselves to you in unexpected ways. There was so much I wanted to say in this song and do it just right that I had it built up as this unscalable mountain that I had to save for last. Lyrics especially are the most difficult aspect for me, and I was dreading the perceived long weeks of staring at an intimidating blank page. Weirdly enough, the lyrics and the musical production of this song came together the fastest out of anything else on this album. This was also a really fun opportunity to mix in elements of trip-hop alongside the electronic rock aspects. And finally, my current favorite song on the record. This was originally going to be a simple acoustic song that showed up either as like a non-album track on the Chapter 2 EP or the upcoming Premonitions album. I didn't have the lyrics done in time to hit the deadline for Chapter 2, so I just kind of relegated it in my head to be included with Premonitions and performed with just an acoustic guitar and a relentless stomp, John Lee Hooker style, basically. But as it swirled around in my head, it wouldn't leave me alone, and the idea began mutating. I wondered what would happen if it were kept as a lo-fi, more organic-sounding song, but very deliberately pieced together electronically and with the same cinematic atmosphere that I've been bathing all these other songs in. The lyrics were written during a long solitary road trip, and to me this song goes hand in hand with the title track. Once it became clear that this was going to be a full-on album song, I knew this had to be the track that closes the album. Musically, it was the most fun to make. Most of these tracks were made by me locked away in a room, laboring away on minuscule elements and beating my head against a wall until somehow everything sounds right, which is usually after first trying everything that doesn't work in order to find what does. This track was done very differently than those other songs. I made a very simple demo to have an arrangement guide, then Clayton of Cell Dweller and I went through some experiments in his studio for getting the sound of the guitars and the vocals. He had parts of the song looping while I played the riff over and over, while Clay fed that signal through multiple analog sources to build layers of this sound to be drenched in a feeling of retro, lo-fi, southern gothic stomper, but just manifesting in like a pristine manner. One of the absolute best times I had recording these takes was Clayton looping various elements and capturing performances while I just went wild with a guitar slide, and I even had it laying down like a pedal steel from hell at one point. Once we assembled the best takes, I went back to my studio to go a bit crazy with laying in some haunting atmospheres and scraping effects. This was all kept deliberately lo-fi and mostly analog, as it's a style I hadn't really done a lot of before, but I love it, and I listen to a lot of music like that. This was also to display that all of the previous songs on the album, with their like tight editing and slick production, are absolutely deliberately so. Blue Stolly has always been, and will always be, a multi-genre project, so this song definitely needed to close the album. The most cathartic bit came at the end of the vocal recording, when the last thing I had to do was the layers of strange voices you hear at the end that close the song and ultimately close the album. For those takes, I had those final tonal pads in my headphones, and I just let everything go. Pacing around the room and being a little bit out of my head. So what you hear in that strange ritual of an ending is all the main takes pitched down an octave while the original takes are reversed in the background. Had to feel like being overtaken and completely lost in the music.